is very relevant to our society. So it is indeed a great pleasure and honor to have Dr. Shabina Madam on this platform. So I am Sunil Chiplunkar representing Group Pharmaceuticals today. And Dr. Shabina Madam, Dr. Shabina, as I will call her henceforth, is a prosthodontist and implantologist who did her BDS from KVG Dental College and Hospital at Sulia. And Sulia is basically a small town, and KVG Dental College is dedicated at providing the right knowledge, skills, and attitude for future dentists to put their best foot forward into healthcare. This small town called Sulia is one of the 7 talukas of Mangalore South Kanara district, also called Dakshina Kannada district, which is well known actually for its freedom fighters. She also did her MDS from Vignan Educational Foundation's Bangalore Institute of Dental Sciences and Research. As a dedicated prosthodontist and implantologist, her interests and procedural skills all revolve around prosthodontic works, whether it is about the fixed and complete and partial dentures, crown and bridge work, implant dentistry, cosmetic dental procedures, and so on. She is highly research-oriented, having presented many papers and delivered lectures on several national and international conferences on interesting topics. She has worked as a senior lecturer, worked in a reputed dental clinic chain as a prosthodontist, and is now a consultant in many private clinics for smile designing. When you think of a prosthodontist, you should think of a specialist who basically replaces the teeth and restores oral health and function. And there are several problems, you know, which are associated with dentures, which is one of the outcomes of going to a prosthodontist. One interesting aspect is the denture breath, which is also called bad breath or halitosis, which is associated with dentures and could be because of what is called as a biofilm on the dentures, that is the sticky growth of the bacteria. And there are other complicating factors like the dry mouth, infections in the mouth, particularly in the elderly subjects who have got hyposalivation, which causes a lot of issues. So denture hygiene and to prevent and correct the denture breath is one of the important aspects. Because if denture hygiene is poor, there could be a lot of issues like the fungal infection, or it could also be the bacterial infection, or there could be the inflammation, redness, which is caused due to the denture, denture-induced stomatitis. There could also be, in worsened cases, a traumatic ulcer and cheilitis, or basically there are inflammatory lesions at the corners of the mouth. So many issues are there related with that of the dentures. In fact, denture hygiene is a very important aspect. They have done a study and they found that among the dental practitioners of Jabalpur city, many of the dentists did not associate the oral biofilms on the denture stomatitis issue. So they also did not coach the patients on denture hygiene. So what we can say is that there is a limited time for dentists sometimes to coach on denture hygiene, and denture hygiene is a very important issue. A survey on patients has revealed that denture hygiene is not very, very good. Nearly half of the subjects, they clean the dentures daily once, which means another half of the respondents did not clean their dentures. And seeing the condition, more than half of the dentures were rated as poor. So what it indicates is that there is a lot of room for improvement in maintaining the denture hygiene, because if denture hygiene is not taken care of, it leads to several complications. And today, the amount of edentulousness or the loss of teeth is increasing because of the aging population. There could be other complications like that of pneumonia, which is due to, again, bad denture hygiene. So a lot of issues are there related to poor denture hygiene. It could be simple mucosal sores to stomatitis. And complicating this is the oral dryness aspect. Hence, Group Pharmaceuticals is happy to introduce what is called as Densive. Densive is basically patented color-changing technology tablets which are used for denture cleansing. So they help improve the denture breath problem, they provide protection from denture infection, and they do not react chemically with dentures and promotes the life of the denture appliance. Densive tablets protect the individual from denture infections. So this is certainly a smart choice for aseptic dentures. Due to the improvement in the denture hygiene, there is also a color changing technology that reinforces the habit of using the dentures, as well as the denture cleaning tablet called Densive. So there is the generation of active oxygen, which helps provide the aseptic dentures and also helps remove the biofilm and also ensures there are no stains. So you get a very good denture, and denture maintenance is excellent with this product. So Densive has picked up very well because of the sodium perborate, as well as because of the PMPS technology. So basically, you put Densive into a glass of water, and within 15 minutes, it changes from colorless to green, from green to blue. So once it changes to blue, you are sure the denture has become aseptic and stain-free, because there is very good cleansing action and anti-stain action due to the activities of Densive, which offers sodium perborate and potassium monosulfate also. So there is a very good friendliness to the environment. There is no toxicity of this product, and damage to dentures on a long-term use is also not there. And the elimination of biofilms and stains takes place with the use of Densive. So do trust Densive for very good denture appliance maintenance and creating an aseptic quality. Oh, what a smile, isn't it? Well, that is Julia Roberts. You see, at the University of California, the Mills College, they studied the class photos of various classes. They found that some girls smiled genuinely. That's called as a Duchenne smile, which reaches up to the eyes. And the researchers tracked down these women 30 years down the line. It's called longitudinal study. And they found that the genuine smilers were blessed with happier lives in terms of marriage, well-being, and career. And that's exactly what dentists, good dentists like Dr. Shabina Madam, do. They help you restore confidence and smile, make you smile confidently. They make you smile with a Duchenne smile, and that will enhance your life. In fact, an encounter with a dentist can be life-changing. And do definitely make a Duchenne smile. Enjoy this excellent webinar that Madam is going to host, and I'm sure that you will be able to get better interaction and get better knowledge on what actually prosthodontic practice is. And also, you will understand what are all the intricacies about prosthodontics. Thank you very much. And now the floor is all yours, Dr. Shabina Madam. The attendees are eager to listen to you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. That was such a warm welcome. Thank you so much. Sir has already introduced, I am Dr. Shabina, prosthodontist. So today we'll be talking about geriatric dentistry, how good care we can take about the older people that are around us. Okay, so to go ahead, we'll start with the introduction today. So prosthodontics mainly focus on dental processes involving diagnosis, treatment planning, rehabilitation of the oral health problems. Is it what I'm saying is right? No. We don't only do that, but we also understand that oral health the older age people require little more of us. That is, maintaining the oral health in older elders has become a challenge and has a major impact on geriatric life. Unlike the younger adults, maintenance of oral health along elderly people is quite dissimilar, as there exist a lot of physical and mental changes in the health that happens. Okay. So in older age, what happens is there is altered oral health. It is quite common in the older people because of the natural aging along with the deterioration of the systemic health. Edentulism, dental caries, periodontal disease, xerostomia, oral malignancies are some of the general oral problems that are faced by our senior citizens. Along with these, the customary oral changes that one can encounter along with geriatric people is the inability to chew food properly, residing gums, diminished salivary secretion, gradual loss of taste sensation, smell detection, while the bodily variation involved incapable of absorbing nutrients, declined immunity, and slow metabolism happens. So the main problems in geriatric patients are poor oral health in geriatric population is the risk factor which is interrelated to the systemic problems. Systemic problems like I'm talking about the respiratory diseases, the cardiovascular diseases, normal diseases like the other diseases like diabetes, all these are systemic diseases. So the oral health is directly or indirectly related to these systemic health issues. Edentulism is a condition in the elderly people which is indirectly related to the malnutrition issues. Why? Because there are no teeth, they cannot chew, so that causes the malnutrition or absorption of the nutrition is less. So coming to what is geriatric dentistry? Geriatric dental education can be defined as that portion of pre-doctoral dental curriculum that deals with special knowledge, attitude, and technical skills required in provision of oral health care for older elders. What is it, gerodontist? Gerodontist is nothing but geriatric dentist. So the difficulties that are faced in access to the older oral health is obesity, snoring, hearing impairment, immobility or mobility constraint, financially independent or financially dependent, congenital impairment, smoking, excessive alcohol consumption, dementia, burning mouth syndrome, dysphagia, and roofing of saliva. Elderly abuse, in that again we have systemic diseases like diabetes mellitus, hypercholesterolemia, cardiovascular diseases, sedentary lifestyle. In respiratory diseases, we have chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, asthma. Then we have in mental diseases, we have Parkinson's syndrome, Alzheimer's. So all these are the systemic diseases that we need to take care in access to the oral health. So first we have to access the oral health of the patient, communicate with the patient, help the patient understand what his oral hygiene is, whether it is poor, good, very good. Help the patient understand that. If there are some issues that we need to treat when we need to treat, what we do is we take a concern. Please take a concern of the patient, so that we can go ahead and get the treatment done. Educate the patient about what is dental caries, what is oral hygiene. Educate the patient. Safety, that is the precaution, is the first measure. So what we have to do is we have to explain how what are the brushing techniques, how we have to rinse our mouth. So all these are the safety measures and special care services for the older people. So older people, most of them cannot walk into our clinics most of the time. Some are bedridden. Some cannot climb the steps. So all these are the special cares that we need to be taken care of in older people. So how do we access? As the bone loss is due to the periodontal disease, excessive coronal and root caries and unresolved periapical lesion, they will be less willing to accept the compromised solutions. Like we have to remove the remaining teeth. So most of the elderly people, what they feel, especially the female elderly people, what they feel, the anterior teeth. For example, you have only 3 anterior teeth left, or you have 4 anterior teeth left. When we tell them they are mobile, we have to remove them, or they are having caries, they are having root caries, we have to remove them. What they say is, no, it is good, it is strong, let it be then, let this be, and then you make the denture. See, you have to explain them, take some photos of the oral cavity with an intraoral camera, do the radiographs, explain them how the teeth should be there. Show them how the healthy teeth looks, how the non-healthy, how their teeth looks. so that they understand. It takes little time, but we have to explain them how it is and then go ahead with the treatment. Same with the complete dentures. When we talk about complete dentures, right, I say that you have to go with the removable complete denture, madam. So what comes first? Oh, it will fall off. It is loose. It is removable. When I talk, if it slips out, when my saliva is falling on the other patient, this is what the basic concern the patient has. So we have to explain them how it is, how much long it takes to get adapted, what is the duration it will take. All this should be explained in detail to the patient. We need to have a lot of patience and then explain why complete dentures are like that. Okay. The topics that I'll be covering today in detail is, we have understood what oral health causes. Oral health is causes systemic diseases, right? There are some systemic diseases that cause oral problem to the oral health also. So they are all interrelated to each other. So dietary advice is also very important. Nowadays we get all the soft drinks. It is available in the every second shop, I think. So we have to explain them the one glass of the soft drink or the Coke that they consume. How much sugar is there? How much sugar is entering into their bloodstream? Coming to the food, avoid junk foods. So we have to explain them why they have to avoid junk foods. Then what is the effectiveness of oral hygiene? How to achieve it? Then fluoride implementation is also required. That also, how to achieve it? Then what are the effects of smoking and consuming alcohol or misusing the substances, other substances? Then how the medication affects, like asthma medication or Parkinson's medication, how these medications affect the oral cavity? Then xerostomia, and what are its harmful effects on the oral cavity? Then the reasons why they have to visit dental clinic, why their dental attendance is very important, is also to be explained. So the common problems that we see in the oral cavity in the elderly patients are erosive areas of enamel, xerostomia, hypersalivation, angular cytosis, extensive dental caries. So all these are the common problems that we address in the older people. So we have to explain. How are we going to explain? The patient is walking in, he's an independent patient or he's financially dependent. Okay, so we have to explain him what is the oral condition, how many caries he's having, or how many missing tooth he's having, how many root stumps he's having, what if it is left in his mouth, what happens, what is the future. You have to explain it to him. Okay. Then the next level, you have to explain it to his caregiver or his family member who's taking care of him. You have to explain him. Or else we have to make a community group, okay, or a club where the senior citizens are walking in. We can explain individual senior citizen, or we have to volunteer ourselves or arrange the volunteers in the group that who can explain these situations to the senior or the elderly patients. Or in the higher level is opening a clinic where there is no clinic, or opening a hospital setup where there is no hospital setup in the areas where there are no hospital setups. These are the few things that we can do in the community level explanation. So starting off with, we will start off with the major, the common problem that every second elderly patient faces is obesity. So what obesity is? It is inadequate or adequate take overweight or intake of the food which is not required causes overweight, or that is called as obesity. So what we have to explain them, we have to explain this food triangle. I'm sure everybody is aware of the food triangle or pyramid. We have to take 5 liters of water. Good. We have to include wheat, rice in our daily diet. We have to include vegetables and fruits in our daily diet, which contains calcium, vitamins. All these should be included in our daily diet. We have to explain the causes why overweight should be avoided. For example, if the patient is overweight, you have to tell them what are the hormonal changes that take place, or what are the stress levels that happen, or you have to explain them the fatty acids, how they react. So what happens? There is a cause of diabetes, cardiovascular disease is caused, then there is breathlessness, or sleep apnea is there, that will lead to disability and then mortality. We have to explain to our patients. So adequate nutritional intake is very important in promoting the oral health and well-being of the patients. Disorder of the oral cavity contributes to poor eating. For example, there is some pain, the loose teeth is there, there is some pain. So what happens, or there is ill-fitting denture, that will reduce, that will result in taking food, the inability to consume food, or they take which is easier food. The patient takes which is easier food to for themselves. Now, how this obesity affects the prosthodontist or a dentist, for example. An obese patient walks in, if, for example, there are three stairs, okay? He walks in, there is a lot of breathlessness. Please make him sit first and then allow him to sit on the dental chair. Make sure that you don't supine your dental chair too much back, because the patient will feel like his stomach is falling onto his face. So don't supine the chair. Try to upright the chair and then do the oral examinations. I understand the oral examination is again difficult because of the chubby cheeks and thick tongue. You will not be, the mouth opening will be very less. So these are the problems that you can face. So you have to make sure that your light is right falling on the oral aperture. Then taking impression is also another difficulty. There are chubby cheeks, the tray will, the corners of the tray will go hurt the cheek, sulcus of the cheek, or lingual sulcus. So there is very, it is very difficult to take the impression. So you have to explain why they have to reduce their weight. All this should be taken care. And then you have to explain why the patient is overweight also. When there is loose teeth or ill-fitting denture or painful caries teeth, explain them this, the caries, this is painful, that's why you're not chewing from them, that side. So you have to correct it, you have to get your oral hygiene done, then then definitely there will be change in the weight. Then next is snoring. So most of them are ashamed of the loud sound that they make when they are asleep. That is called as snoring. Okay. So why does the snoring happens? Because of the gravity, the muscles relax. Okay. The gravity and the muscles relax, which falls down to the throat. All the soft tissues fall back to the throat, resulting in constriction of the air to flow. So because of which, when the air flows, there is very, there's a lot of vibration that happens. Because of this vibration, what happens? Sound is produced. Okay. So this sound is produced. Now what happens is, what is the major, sound is not the problem. What happens is after that, there is disturbance of the sleep. The patient gets up because of the sound, or sometimes there is sleep apnea. Sleep apnea is sudden waking up from the sleep because you're not able to breathe. There is obstruction of the respiratory tract. So you're not able to breathe. Because of this, you will feel very much difficulty in sleeping. If you're not, if you, there is lack of sleep, then definitely it will lead to systemic diseases. Okay, these systemic diseases, like you have hypertension, then diabetes, then xerostomia, mood swings, all these are related to each other. So what we have to do is, we prosthodontists, we have something called as snore guard. Here what happens, we have two snore guards. We have to make a splint. That is, two splints are there, upper jaw splint and lower jaw splint. The lower jaw splint is either is held in the predetermined position, or it is advanced by two connectors, that is on the lateral side. Thus it contracts the narrowing of the respiratory tract. The velocity of the inspired air decreases, and so do the sound. Generating vibrations of the tissue is also reduced. With this, the jaw movement is possible, but no falling back of the jaw happens. That means with this device, the device you can see here with the their upper and lower splints are there, which is laterally attached. So what happens here is, these splints are made and your lower jaw is not falling back, or it is not falling onto the throat, because of which there is no there are no vibrations that are produced. So there is no sound. Okay, with this, the patient is very comfortable. He's able to do his regular like jaw movements, and even it is acting as a snore guard. So this is very nice. And coming next to the hearing impairment. Hearing impairment are of three types. That is sensorineural, mixed, and conductive. Sensorineural is because of aging, noise damage, or drug side effects, auditory tumors, or blasts that can happen. These are about sensory neurons. Now, mixed are genetic rehab because of genetics, infection, or head traumas. Then conductive is because of fluid is there, or wax blockage is there, or rupture of the eardrum is there because of that. So, for example, if elderly patients are unable to wear hearing aids, some patients, yeah, definitely they can wear hearing aids and they can hear to you. But some patients, they cannot wear hearing aids. Such patients, like where there is decreased auditory input or decreased nerve activity, structural damage or structural changes in the brain, verbal communication is difficult, decreased socialization, depression, anxiety, and social isolation. Such patients, they cannot use the hearing aids. So in here, it is very important that you don't speak loud to these patients. First thing, you should never be loud in front of them. And second thing is, don't use the third person. You should not use the third person as, you know, to explain your treatment or to explain what you're doing. Try to use sign languages. This is the best that I can, that I have been using. I have never used the third person, or I have never spoken aloud to my patients. Either I go very close to them or I use the sign language. So the sign language is the best language. So they are connected to you. You see to their eyes, you explain them what you're doing. They believe in you. They see into your eyes and they believe in you that the treatment that you're doing is the best that you're doing to them. So that is what I want to tell about hearing impairment. The next will be mobility constraints. So for example, the people are, people, you have to do the environment age friendly, make sure there are very less steps. For example, if your clinic or your setup is on the first floor or second floor, make sure that there is lift, make sure that wheelchair facility is there, and there is sloping, next to the steps there is slopingness so that the patient can come up and go down very easily. Don't give late appointments. Try to give early appointments. If the patient walks in, try to finish your appointment and then immediately take him as the next patient. Try not to make them wait for a longer time. For the elderly patients, not only if some disease is there, but make sure that, because they get very restless very fast. So I request you to finish their appointments faster. Coming to the now, this is very important, financially independent or financially dependent patient. When, for example, your patient is financially independent. Okay, say your patient is financially independent. So now what this older patient is, he is taking care of his family, say his wife, if not his children, his wife. And then he's taking care of his other health issues. So try to, you know, budgetize the treatment. Try to, you know, give a budget treatment for him so that he can afford this treatment and go ahead, okay? And if he is dependent, say he is dependent on his son, okay, or a caregiver, you explain the caregiver why this treatment is to be done, why he has to undergo this treatment, after this treatment, what will be his lifestyle. So this is very important to be explained to the caregiver. There was a study which was done. Usually at the age like 25 to 59 is the time where the people are independent. They are earning and eating. After that age, they say that most of them are not earning and eating. They're basically dependent. Smoking. So all of us know what does smoking cause, which how it affects the oral cavity. I'll just picture here. You can see the upper palate. It is basically the smoker's palate. It is the inflammation of the salivary glands. Here, the older elders, they don't understand that there are some taste buds in the roof of the palate, or there are a roof of the mouth. Okay, in the palate, there are some taste buds. So what they do is they wear the dentures nicely. They put the adhesive also on the denture and wear. But what happens? They're cutting down the taste buds of the roof, right? So please explain them that they should not do. I know it happens that not most of the patients get a full tight upper denture, but then please explain them what harm they are doing to their soft tissues. Coming to the excessive alcohol, yes, drinking milk is much better than drinking alcohol. So basically, there are oral cancer is formed, then oral chances of oral cancer, caries, mouth smelling of the mouth, bad breath. So all these are the causes of excessive alcohol, plus systemic diseases are also caused. Then dementia. In dementia, what happens is the patient forgets what has happened. So you have to explain the caregiver that how to take care of the oral hygiene, or how to maintain the oral hygiene. The main thing is you have to explain to the caregiver if the patient is not eating from that side, if the patient is having pain in that side, what are the side effects of the systemic medicines, or the medicines that he's taking, what are the side effects on the oral cavity or on the other part of the body. You have to explain to the caregiver what the dementia patient undergoes. They basically have very poor oral health because they are forgetting. They forget that they have brushed their teeth. They feel that they have brushed their teeth and they don't brush it, right? So what you have to tell the caregiver, if they ask, if they have not brushed, let them brush again. There is no harm in brushing thrice a day or four times a day, rather than not brushing for 2-3 days, right? So you can just, whenever they remember that they have to brush, just let them go and brush, okay? That is the best way to maintain the oral hygiene. It is the same when it happens, like, you know, when we have a very important procedure today to be done in the clinic and patient forgets. So make sure that the caregiver, the caretaker or the caregiver knows about this appointment and gets the patient to your clinic. So that is about maintaining the oral health relationship with these patients is very difficult. Why? Because when the patient walks in, I'm full, like first time he's walking in, I'm having a lot of energy. I explain him all the procedures. I explain him what I'm going to do today. I'm explaining him even what will happen in the next appointment. I'm doing everything. I'm at my best today. Next appointment, for sure, he does not remember me. So what happens? I lose a little bit of interest. Yeah, that should not happen. Why? Because it is not the patient's mistake. We have to explain what we have done to the previous, what we have done previously, and what should be done next. That is the best way that we have to maintain the rapport with these patients. Burning mouth syndrome. Burning mouth syndrome is the causes are usually because viral, idiopathic, or systemic diseases. So how it is very important when we are doing tooth preparation, for example, if the burr touches the tongue. So, you know, it is going to cause a severe pain to the patient. Especially with the burning mouth syndrome, it is the patient is going to feel a lot of pain, not for days, for weeks. So you should be very careful not to hurt the patient whenever you're doing a dental procedure. Even if you're taking impressions, say you're doing border molding, secondary impression, when you're doing, if the wax is a little hot, make sure that, you know, it is cold, then you put inside the mouth and then do the molding, okay? With the burning mouth patient syndrome, the home remedies are drinking a lot of water, avoid rash substance, then consider natural supplements, eat healthier food, make your food softer, reduce stress. These are the home remedies for the burning mouth syndrome. Then dysphagia and roofing. So what are the signs of dysphagia and roofing? In normal, what happens is there is cough, choking, then a patient keeps a lot of food for in the cheeks or below the tongue for a longer time and then swallows. There is painful swallowing and roofing of saliva. This happens mainly with the denture patients when the denture flanges are overextended or the denture wearers, the elderly patient is wearing the denture for the first time. He has never worn a removable prosthesis, whether it is RPD or complete denture. So he feels very difficult in swallowing. He feels very difficult in chewing. He feels that his tongue is getting hurt. Whenever he swallows, his tongue is touching a foreign body. It touches the posterior palate, right? So the posterior palate has a denture plate where the tongue touches. Because of that, he feels very some foreign body is there, and he feels that the foot is entering the dentures, like the tissue surface and the denture. So he feels, you know, all this is very very common in the denture patients, and they feel there is a lot of salivation in the starting. The patient like, for example, they say that when you smell pickle, you start salivating. In the same way, when there is a new foreign body in the mouth, there is a lot of salivation, because of which there is roofing. So you should explain to the patient that it will take time. This is how it is going to be. So so it has to be taken time, and then we can go ahead with the dentures. After 3 to 6 months, he'll be comfortable. It will feel, he'll feel that the denture mouth is his own. The denture is his own. It is his mouth. He won't feel like it is something else. So you have to give some time. You have to explain to the patient how it is. Okay. Then elderly abuse. Elderly abuse is, there are different types of abuses that happen, whether it is financial, physical, or whether it is in health matters or sexual matters. So what physically? So there are different types of abuses. Here we'll be mainly talking about the oral health care that we'll be dealing with. So if the patient is having lot of caries, okay, lot of pain everywhere, abscess is there, that means definitely that the patient is not being taken care by the caregiver. The patient is being ignored or is under some kind of abuse, right? So you have to make sure that you inform to the higher authorities or inform to the local area individuals that what is the situation, why is it like this. So, and then explain them how the how the oral health or elderly or matured mouth should be and how it should be taken care of, how the abscess should be treated. All these details should be explained and then treated. Then diabetes mellitus, it is very common now. Every second person or every third person who walks into the clinic has diabetes. So like they say, 1 in 5 cases, tooth loss is because of diabetes. So oral health and diabetes is related to each other. Okay, so there are 6 major problems that are faced by in diabetes mellitus. That is excessive toothache, taste impairment, delayed healing, gum disease, salivary gland dysfunction, and fungal diseases. That is the oral thrush, candidiasis that is seen. So all these are the common problems that we see in diabetes patients. Diabetes patients, whenever we do tooth extraction, for example, there are some root stumps left before we fabricate the complete denture. So we should make sure that the patient understand that he is a diabetic patient. Whenever I'm trying to do a surgical procedure, whether it is a tooth extraction or ridge augmentation, there is going to be a delayed healing. He has to wait for the complete healing of the soft tissue, and then the complete denture will be delivered. Once the complete denture is delivered, even the smallest, say roughness, or the he feels that rash is there, that healing also will take time. So all this should be explained prior to the patient, before the procedure is being started. Because the healing is delayed in diabetes. Then coming to hypercholesterolemia, here you can see that when there is a lot of bacteria in the mouth, it goes into the bloodstream. It takes the uh, it take it gets connected with the fatty acids, it blocks the blood vessels and ultimately leading to the blocks. So this is about the hypocholesterolemia. Then coming to cardiovascular diseases, say your great-grandparents both had cardiovascular disease, that is your father, your grandfather, both the grandfathers and the grandmother, that is all the three children get the cardiovascular disease, then their daughter get the disease and their child. Whereas when both are having cardiovascular disease, then their son gets the disease and both the children get the disease. So this is the family history of cardiovascular disease. So basically, I have already explained what happens when there is a lot of calculus or bacteria that is present in the oral cavity that flows to the bloodstream, causes heart problems. Sedentary lifestyle is basically when you're lazy, when you're sitting, like you eat everything you want, anything you want, and you sit in one place, you don't want to walk around. So what does it cause? It causes lot of systemic diseases like hypertension, chest pain, weight gain, obesity, risk factors like depression, then immunosuppressants, immunosystem is compromised, then physical disability happens. So what we have to do? We have to explain the patient about why he's undergoing all this, then brisk walking, doing household work, physical activity, avoid junk food, drinking a lot of water will help in correcting these lifestyle. In when these lifestyle, especially why I'm talking about this lifestyle is, for example, there is a caries. So what happens, the patient becomes so lazy that he, even if there is slight sensitivity or slight pain, he ignores it. Not because he has to pay for the dentist or he has to, you know, he feels that I have to walk to the dentist, go through the procedure. No, I'm not going to do that. Let me leave. It'll get rectified by itself. No, you have to explain that it's not going to get rectified by itself. In fact, it is going to cause a lot of more problem. If he doesn't get the filling done, then definitely it will go to root canal. If the root canal is not done, then definitely it will cause infection and swelling, which will cause extraction. And once the extraction is done, there is edentulism. Because of edentulism, he will not be able to chew his food. So you have to explain all these things to the patient. Next disease that I will be talking about is asthma. So we'll go what are the treatment plans, symptoms, and the risk factors of asthma. The symptoms are wheezing, breathing hard, chest, frequency of coughing, allergens, common cold, frequently getting common cold. Is the symptoms, causes are like pollution, smoke, genetic, fatty food, dust, pets, all bacteria, all these are the cause factors. Dental causes of dental caries are very common factors. Oral candidiasis happens, dental erosion happens, periodontal diseases, xerostomia, halitosis, altered taste, oral health problems that we see in asthmatic patients, these are the oral health problems. When we take the asthmatic medication also, there are some problems like periodontal diseases, dental caries, dental erosion, oral candidiasis are the few of the dental diseases that we see. So how can we correct it? By regular brushing, regular rinsing of your mouth, taking regular counseling of how your mouth is, taking milk or drinking water immediately after using inhaler. So all this will help in maintaining the oral health. So this is what I was telling, when the patient walks in, try to give space, appliances for the inhalers, try to implement fluoride lenses, then try to use water or drink milk immediately after using the inhaler, then use softer brushes, use sugar-free chewing gums during esophageal events. So all this is very important. Then coming to the respiratory diseases, in respiratory diseases, talking about chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, we can see that there is a lot of inflammation in pharynx, soft palate, oral cavity. There are a lot of infections that happen. So these are the, I've already spoken about asthma, then lung cancer, then tuberculosis, then there are a lot of irregular ulcers that are seen in tuberculosis.
Yes, madam, any issues are there? I think there must be some connectivity issues. We'll just wait. It can happen sometimes, these technical glitches. Right. Please continue, madam. You are lost in between for a few seconds. Please continue.
Okay, fine. So, yeah. I was talking about dysphagia in Parkinson's disease. There is swallowing problem.
Madam, again, we have lost you. I think there is some issue there with the internet technology. I'll just wait. Within a minute or two, madam will be there. Sometimes happens due to the various internet glitches. Madam, are you there? Can you
hello?
Hear
yeah,
me?
I'm there. Can you hear? Yeah. Sorry, yeah. I think it got disconnected. So to continue, we have, we'll start off with, in mental diseases, we have Parkinson's disease, which I have already explained that there is dysphagia and drooping in the Parkinson's disease. We have to make sure that the soft tissue, soft diet is given to the patient. The act of swallowing involves a complex series of activities that begin in the mouth, continue in the pharynx, and end up in the esophage. These include chewing, using the tongue movement, the bolus is pushed back into the throat, and then coordinating the muscles that both the prop of the foot in the bolus. Swallowing dysphagia can be considered both in motor and non-motor symptoms of Parkinson's disease. So this is about how we have to swallow. So there is slow rate of eating. People with difficulty in swallowing may slow down their eating in order to avoid coughing and choking. That is fine if they are eating slowly, it's fine. But make sure that they are eating, enjoying their food. The sensation of food is sticking to the throat. That is also there. The sensation of food getting sticking to the throat will be felt. There is cough. So give in between, try to drink a little bit of water. There is difficulty in swallowing pills. Then unexplained weight loss. Because of the difficulty in swallowing, the patient usually escapes eating to avoid coughing and choking. Patient escapes eating, or there is change in dietary habits. Like patient usually eats what is easy to eat so that he does not feel difficulty while swallowing. So these things should be taken care. We should see where the patient is not eating, or why the patient is eating particular food. So patient usually will not tell us that this is the problem I'm facing, or what happens is he will get adapted to the problem that is being faced by changing the dietary habits. So these should be taken care of. How we take care of this when the patient comes for the first visit? Concern the patient, patient's physician about the disease, at what stage the disease is. Try to finish the treatment in the starting stages of Parkinson's disease. Let the last stages are very, very difficult for the patient to cope up with whatever the treatment we are doing. So try to you know, if it is in the starting stages, try to complete as much as treatment as possible in the starting stages. Okay, then don't extend your appointment more than 45 minutes, and don't make the patient wait for a longer time. If the patient walks in, try to take in the patient for the treatment without making him wait. Then make sure that whenever you're administrating the local anesthetic agent, don't give more than 2 cartridges. That is very important. And for the each cartridge, try to give 30 minutes of gap. And make sure that whenever you're prescribing the medicines, what medicines you're prescribing, whether it is interacting with the other medicines, the patient does not have any motor diseases, like motor diseases problems, or it does not hamper the dosage of the other medicine that he's taking care. So make sure that all this is taken care. Then congenitive impairment. See, like oral cavity, like I already told you how oral cavity helps is very important for the systemic diseases. You have to maintain the oral hygiene. So if at all there is, you know, a lot of caries, if the poor oral hygiene is there, then there is, you know, infection which reaches the brain. There is a neurodegenerative disease, morphologic changes are there. So all this is the systemic diagram that is being shown here. Then telehealth technology. This is now after the lockdown, this has been developed very, very nicely. This is being followed almost everywhere. So virtual dental examinations have been shown to be acceptable substitute for inpatient examination oral health system for aging. For example, you're not having a healthy environment for the patient. What do you do? Then you try to do a virtual setup so that you can do a virtual examination for the examination of the patient. Through the use of telemedicine in dentistry, the concept of virtual dental home has evolved. The virtual dental home is based on the principle of bringing care to the places where underserved population live, work, or social or receive social, educational, or general health services. Integrating oral health with general health, social, and educational delivery systems, and using telehealth technology to connect a geographic disturbance. So basically, what I'm trying to explain is when the patient is not able to walk into us, we have to, you know, set up a telehealth technology or telehealth communication so that we can, you know, at least the appointments where we are not physically required can be done. If at all the physically requirement is necessary, then yes, we can, you know, we can go to the setups, we can go to the hospitals where they are, or we can go to the homes, age-old homes where they are. We can go to those places, whichever the appointments that cannot be done virtually, which requires our presence, we have to go to those places, to their comfort zone, and do the treatment. Most of them, it is not possible, but yeah, this will definitely help the elderly people, the geriatric people, we'll be able to achieve the oral hygiene for such patients. To conclude, I would like to tell how the elderly people management is. The elderly people level of service to the prosthodontics is very, very difficult. Yeah, I understand, because of the age, because of the complexity, making a prosthesis in the lab and inserting into the mouth and asking them to use as their own teeth is very difficult. Yes, so we have to explain how it is, and if at all there is a problem, if at all they feel it is loose, it is uncomfortable, make sure you go with dental implants. Dental implants is very much developed and very much been useful. So it is very helpful for them if they feel it is loose. So this is how it is. Geriatric patients are a different set of patients and require different treatment opportunities, treatments. So that is all I want to tell. Thank you so much.
Thank you, madam. It was amazing. Actually, there are a lot of encomiums. People are heartily appreciating your talk.
Thank you. Very good slide deck.
You have comprehensively treated the subject. Madam, there is a question. If you don't mind, I'll ask one or two questions.
Yeah, sure.
Can you please shed more light on the snore guard concept?
Snore guards is basically what happens is we make the impression of the upper and the lower jaw. We take the what we say is we take the bite. Okay, we take the bite in such a way that the lower jaw is in the rest position. Okay, so that when the patient wears this and sleep, the splints that are attached laterally will help the jaw be in the same position. It won't help, it won't make the jaw fall back to the throat or the tongue to fall back to the throat. So this will help the obstruction will not be there, and the air that is there, the vibrations that are produced will not be there. So the snoring will reduce down, or there is zero snoring in some of the patients that I have done. So this is very helpful for patients, and actually more than patients, I think the neighboring person who next to the patient who sleeps, she was very happy. That's what I will say.
Yes, madam. This is actually a very common and important problem, particularly as the person ages, there is a tendency for snoring frequency to increase or its intensity. This is what we have also heard. Madam, there's another question regarding the smoker's palate. Can you give more details on that?
Yeah, smoker's palate, because what happens is there is a lot of smoke that is being held in the mouth before the smoke is released. And because of which the temperature of the oral cavity increases. Okay, because the temperature increases, the salivary glands that are present that get inflamed. Because inflammation, or they get blocked sometimes, because of which they redness, or you see minute papules are seen, small elevations are seen on the palate. That is nothing but smoker's palate.
Oh, okay. So that's a very important point. Madam, there's also a question regarding your recommendation on the ideal number of brushings per day. How many do you think?
I think two is what we suggest for everyone. But yeah, in patients where people forget, or people, if elderly people are there, you know, it is they are very slow. Some people are very fast. In that conditions, yeah, if you have forgotten that you have brushed today, there is no harm in going and brushing again, rather than, you know, it's okay, I'll brush tomorrow, rather than thinking that way.
Okay, so minimum two, and if it increases to more than two, three or four also, there will be no harm. Okay, thank you. That was a very important point. Madam, this is an interesting insight. It's not directly on prosthodontics. Okay. Dr. Rekha Shetty, madam, is just generally remarking that you refer to the budgeting in elderly subjects.
Yeah.
So she's remarking that there should be some regulation also on this. Legal regulation or so, because age subjects are sometimes not taken care of by the progeny.
Yeah, I understand that. But, you know, for example, if a CT patient walks into my clinic, I say 30,000 for a complete denture. Okay, and he reduces to 25. I feel like, okay, if he's reducing, there is something that is there in his mind, and that's why he's reducing. But sometimes what happens, it will not fall in our budget. So because we have to give to the lab technician, we have to give to the assistant, we have to give to the, you know, materials used in the clinic, sometimes it will not fall in our budget. So I feel like, you know, in India, it is not possible to make a single price for everyone. Right now, maybe in future, yeah, definitely. But right now, we cannot make like this much is the price for this. We cannot do that right now, I think.
I think she was not referring to that sort of regulation on the price, madam. She was referring to the regulation of giving benefit to the elderly. That is, the younger people should take care of the elderly.
Yes, that is, that depends upon the family members.
Yeah. And madam, how long should a person brush? Is it for 2 minutes, 3 minutes, whatever? I mean, there are so many doubts on that.
Brushing, I think 5 minutes, 10 minutes, it does not matter. Okay, if you're brushing in a proper way, covering all the surfaces of the teeth, covering the tongue, if at all there is usually what happens, there is a gap between the last teeth, there is some food that is getting collected in the distal surface. So covering all these surfaces is more important than the time.
Yes, madam. And madam, how common is this denture stomatitis issue or denture-related mucosal sores, etc.? I think again we have lost, madam. Ah, madam,
Tell me.
yeah. Can you please comment on the denture-related problems like denture sores and denture stomatitis or?
Denture sore, denture stomatitis, then we have angulocheilitis, then roofing problem is there, saliva roofing. Then what happens is whenever there are overextensions, then in relation to the overextensions, there are a lot of ulcers that are there. Then if the VD vertical height is increased or decreased, then the angle of the mouth gets hurt. If there is a lot of vertical height, then because of this stretching of the muscles, you feel like there is a cut on the angle of the mouth. So all these are the normal issues that the patient faces in the starting of when the patient starts to wear the denture.
Okay, madam. So, what is your suggestion on that concept?
Making a proper denture, and it's not like once we deliver the denture, the patient is completely happy. No patient is completely happy. There are some issues. Address those issues. Make sure that the patient is got adapted to those issues, and then I think after the time of 3 to 4 months, when the patient walks in, for example, for some correction in the denture, the patient never give you want to take out the denture from the patient mouths. The patient will never do that. The patient will say, "I will remove my denture and give." He won't say, "It's your denture, you take it." It's my denture, it's my mouth, so I will remove and give. That one sentence, I think everybody should look out for.
Okay. So sense of ownership.
Yes.
Madam, how is the denture hygiene practice generally in your observation, like of the denture wearers?
Yeah, the denture hygiene is quite good. It depends like how much educated the patient is. For example, most of the some of the patient who walk in, they have not removed the denture after the insertion at all, not even in the night, because
My
they feel
God.
they have to remove and they have to put in the water again in the morning when they wear. There are so many, especially in joint family, it happens that they don't want their grandchildren to see them without teeth. So what they do is they don't remove only. So that we have to educate the patient why it is important to remove, keep it in the water in the night, and then brush and then wear it. It's very important to explain that to the patients.
Oh my. Madam, what's the role of denture cleaning tablets? Like we have recently launched Densive, so can you make
I feel it has been very good because most of the patients are not educated on how to clean the dentures. Usually, what they do is how we brush the teeth. That is how they brush the dentures also. They use the paste, they use the brush, and start brushing the dentures. That is not the right way. Most of the patients, I have explained them that this is not the right way to do because it will cause abrasion on the dentures. The polish will go off, and ultimately lead the food to get entrapped in those areas and then cause different oral hygiene problems. So we have to explain why then we have to use denture cleaning tablets.
Okay, that was amazing, ma'am. You got in-depth and very lucid understanding of the practical aspects of prosthodontics, and that has been very illuminating to all the people who have come here, including from the Gulf. Some people have joined in, so it has been a very nice webinar and presentation. We thank you so much, madam. And do you
Thank
have
you,
any
thank you.
concluding remarks? And then we can close the webinar.
I think I have told all.
Thank you so much, madam. It was indeed a great webinar. I take your permission and I thank all the attendees for being with us. And I take your permission, madam, to close the webinar. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.